The film follows three primary characters.
Rick Dalton,
who was the former star of a 1950s Western television series called
Bounty Law.
You don't ever bring him in alive, now do you, Jake?
Not when there's three of them and one of me.
What are you looking at, bounty killer?
Looking at an ugly owl who's about to get his jaw busted. Amateurs try and take men in alive. Amateurs usually don't make it.
Whether you're dead or alive, you're just a dollar sign to Jake Cahill on Bounty Law.
Bounty Law. He fears his career is fading as he's not sure how to transition into the new Hollywood era.
So, Rick, who's gonna kick the shit out of you next week? Mannix? The man from Uncle? The girl from Uncle? How about Batman and Robin?
Ping! Pow!
Zoom! Zoom! Down goes you, down goes your career as a leading man.
Then there's
Cliff Booth,
who's Rick's best friend and stunt double.
Explain to the audience exactly what it is a stunt double does.
Well, actors are required to do a lot of dangerous stuff. Say Jake Cahill gets shot off his horse. Now, can I fall off a horse? Yes, I can. Yes, I have. But say I fall off wrong and I sprain my wrist or I twist my ankle. Now, that can put an undue burden on production because now maybe I can't work for a week. So Cliff here is meant to help carry the load.
Is that how you describe your job, Cliff?
What, carrying his load? Yeah, it's about right.
And not to mention that Cliff Booth has also
killed his fucking wife,
which causes a rift in his career. He also has trouble transitioning into the new Hollywood era of 1969 with films like
Bonnie and Clyde, Five Easy Pieces,
Easy Rider,
and directors like Dennis Hopper were changing cinema at the time.
Create, which is what movies are to me and what drama is to me, is a game.
35-year-old men had taken over show business.
Hollywood was changing in the 70s, changing huge.
And then you have
Sharon Tate.
Sharon Tate, who goes to see a movie, I guess.
Quentin, you have put Margot Robbie, a very talented actress, actor, in your film. She was in the Leonardo in Wolf of Wall Street, I, Tonya. This is a, you know, person with a great deal of acting talent, and yet you haven't really given her many lines in the movie. And I wondered, I guess that was a deliberate choice on your part, and I just wanted to know why that was, that we don't hear her actually speaking very much. And Margot, I wanted you to also comment about being in the film in this part.
Well, I just reject your hypotheses.
Something else that absolutely shocked me about this movie is the fact that Margot Robbie has like two fucking lines in this whole movie. She barely talks and she barely has any interesting scenes. I was waiting this entire movie for Margot Robbie to have like a really powerfully acted scene, but throughout the entire film, it's just the camera following her around, doing errands. She goes and watches her own movie to make sure the audience is laughing at her performance, which does come across really sweet, but it's a scene that drags on for like 5 minutes. And again, Margot Robbie is not saying anything. She's just portraying the same delighted, giggly emotion the entire movie.
Some of the things I want to look at in this review pertains to storytelling, how Quentin Tarantino tells a story, specifically how he tells this story in Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. That means how he builds the story, how the narrative flows, and the characters that he uses in the story. How does he use those characters to tell it? And More than that, we're also going to be looking at Quentin Tarantino's treatment of women in the film, as this movie has received a lot of criticisms with regards to that specifically. So I want to also look at whether or not those criticisms hold any water to them, hold any weight to them.
But I did feel once again, and I, you know, at the risk of sounding like a stuck record, that for me, when what I want is precision and concision, you don't get that from Tarantino. What you get is you wander into this world and you sort of inhabit it for a very long time. And then about 2 hours in, it stops and there's a voiceover which explains a whole bunch. You just think, you've had 2 hours and now there's a voiceover explaining a whole bunch. It's like, what were you doing for the 2 hours? And again, I would say that my frustration with Tarantino is because there are moments when he demonstrates how brilliant he is that I just expect more from him. Again, stuck record time. I think his best film is Jackie Brown. I think it's the one film in which not everybody talks like a Tarantino character. There is a young character in this who talks exactly like a Tarantino character. And I kind of felt like, okay, that's we're back in that world again. So the things that delighted and pleased me were that there are, you know, as I said, it's complete. I don't think it is exploitative at all. And I really enjoyed the things that we can't talk about. And I thought that there was, you know, you can feel the love of cinema in it, but I thought it was fantastically ill-disciplined and indulgent. And I thought there was certain just whole blocks in it that seriously somebody just would have gone, that's a DVD extra. Just take that out.
For me, precision in a film is important. I appreciate a film that is organized like a Swiss watch, wherein all of the mechanisms of the watch are intelligently designed and beautifully layered. All of the mechanisms of a beautifully assembled watch would have every piece shift and move so that the other can shift and move and turn the entire clock. The smallest piece in a clock is integral to the overall function as a whole. As in a beautifully assembled story, every small plot reference within that story has its grander point to the larger narrative, or else it'll just be a waste of time.
We call it cutting. It isn't exactly that. Cutting implies severing something. It really should be called assembly. Mosaic is assembling something to create a whole. Montage means the assembly of pieces of film, which moved in rapid succession before the eye, create an idea.
And it's in the editing room where the editor assembles all of the necessary pieces of the story and discards all of the unimportant bits that aren't really needed. But Tarantino doesn't do this. What Tarantino instead does is waste the time of the audience. He fills the narrative with useless fat that doesn't exist to benefit the overall narrative of the plot that would normally make it tick.
There's a scene where she goes to a party and she just dances for 2 minutes while another guy at the party tells us about her life.
She was engaged to him. Then she flew to the UK. to make a film with him. I broke off her engagement with him and married him. Then they moved to Los Angeles, and the three of them have been inseparable.
She's portrayed as, in my opinion, this male fantasy of the ditzy, innocent, beautiful girl who doesn't know that she's beautiful, who doesn't know her own intelligence, who really doesn't speak often and is always like happy and dancy and happy to be looked at by men. It just rubs me the wrong way, especially like in fucking 2019 when everybody knows that we need to give female characters depth. I do understand that it's a bit of a complicated issue though, because
one thing that really frustrated me about this film was
women.
Yeah, this is probably the shittiest weather ever. The shittiest weather on the shittiest boat with the shittiest person. Natalie, my sister, said he's a loser. He's a loser. They all said it. He's a fucking loser.
I know,
loser.
I know.
So I guess I'm a fucking idiot. Now you're not gonna talk to me? What, you don't feel excited? Well, I feel like fucking fighting because I've been up here by myself for 4 hours on this fucking shithole of a boat!
A lot of critics have levied accusations of sexism against its female characters in the film, and that's something I want to take a look at. I want to see if that criticism is warranted by looking at a specific scene in the film that really stuck out to me in terms of how it was presented to the audience, in terms of what it said about the woman in the scene, and how it was edited together to give that impression.
You know, this is probably the shittiest weather ever. The shittiest weather on the shittiest boat with the shittiest person. Natalie, my sister, said he's a loser. He's a loser. They all said it. He's a fucking loser, and I didn't believe them. So I guess I'm the fucking idiot. Now you're not gonna talk to me? What, you don't feel like fighting? Well, I feel like fucking fighting because I've been up here by myself for 4 hours on this fucking shithole of a boat.
Why did Cliff Booth kill his wife? By inserting that, by having that question bubble up in the audience's mind, and then given this clip of this shrill, shrieking woman sort of nagging Cliff, and up until this point, your perception, how you perceive Cliff Booth is that you like him. You really like him. You know, Quentin Tarantino is really good at building likable characters. So you've connected to this character. Now you're seeing this character being berated and mocked and attacked by this shrill woman. What you're supposed to get away with that is that, oh, she deserved it. Oh, of course he killed his wife. How could you blame him? That's sort of, I think, where the issue comes in for me, is that by using this really good editing technique, the implication that's given, that's kind of explicit, is that Cliff Booth is at least what's the position that the audience is being groomed into, is that Cliff Booth, how could you blame him for doing what he did, for killing his wife? Regardless of whether or not he did it on purpose, the perception, that the framework that the movie is giving you, is that it's justified. And then I think that's sort of where a massive issue comes in.
Then it's also revealed that Pitt's character is persona non grata around the studios because he's known for having killed his wife and gotten away with it. What? And we see the moment right before her death where, and she looks gorgeous, by the way, but she's yelling at Pitt on the boat, calling him a loser, etc. And the clear subtext is, who can blame him for killing her, right? But here's the problem. Perception is really important. And I've seen a number of guys, Bill Burr makes jokes about it all the time, that they see women as being shrewish. But I can tell you, as a woman, that often when women are just trying to communicate and trying to, you know, just make their feelings heard, or just, you know, not wanting to just walk away from the guy, it's seen as shrewish, but it's not actually shrewish. So that's why you can't kill your spouse.